As the weather improves, road construction projects move into high gear. Learn about improvements coming to Puyallup Shaw Road. And we'll discuss the details of the South Hill Neighborhood Plan. Plus, what's an ad hoc committee and how it influences county council decisions. All that is coming up right now on Pierce County Talks. Welcome to Pierce County Talks. It's called State Highway 161, but South Hill residents know it better as Meridian Avenue, the main drag that runs through the middle of this Puyallup community. The bustling corridor now has a green light for future land development. Reporter Heather Radall looks at the Puyallup City Council's South Hill Neighborhood Plan.
The Puyallup City Council's final adoption of the South Hill Neighborhood Plan involves zoning changes for the area. Those changes are expected to clear the path for more retail and residential development.
We've expanded the zoning allowances for a greater mix of both residential and employment uses, retail and other commercial uses, hopefully to make that zoning a little more flexible and allow property owners greater variety when they're proposing future development on their property.
Baker adds that the city is already seeing a growing interest from potential developers.
We're seeing increased desire particularly for retirement apartments in this area. So we know that it's a desirable place where people can access a wide range of uses.
The South Hill neighborhood is one of Puyallup's two regional growth centers focused on encouraging transportation and economic development.
The South Hill neighborhood plan took effect February 28th, and it directs the future growth of one of Puyallup's two regional growth centers. Joining me now to talk about the South Hill neighborhood plan is Puyallup senior planner, Katie Baker. Katie, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, let's talk about the South Hill neighborhood plan. How do you describe what that document is?
Sure, so the South Hill neighborhood plan is really a framework document to establish a new vision for the South Hill neighborhood. That's effectively the area around Bradley Lake Park, the South Hill Mall, and the YMCA. So really that area is intended to accommodate much of the future growth in both housing and employment in the city.
What does that kind of mean for economic development looking for the future? What's kind of the future look of South Hill?
Sure. So one of the major changes that's taken place with this new plan document is an increase in zoning flexibility, so increasing building heights and use allowances in much of the neighborhood. So we anticipate seeing new housing uses, a lot more senior housing in the area, but also potentially new employment uses as well, more office buildings and other retail opportunities.
Meridian is kind of known as a very busy corridor, mm-hmm. especially during peak rush hour.
Certainly.
What's kind of in the plan for addressing those concerns mm-hmm. for residents?
So I guess the first thing to note is that a lot of the traffic congestion and traffic issues in the city, in that part of the city, are really due to a lot of development outside city limits that we don't really have much control over. But certainly the plan addresses those traffic concerns, and we have identified a number of traffic improvements that are needed in the area. We also anticipate that with a lot of the new growth coming into this center, there'll be more opportunities to support multimodal transportation options. So increased bus service, bike and pedestrian opportunities throughout the neighborhood.
You kind of alluded to the fact that there's a lot of growth outside of city limits. Can you just explain to us where the city limits are? So where does that reach?
Sure. So this south city limit for the city of Puyallup is essentially where the YMCA, the Michaels Shopping Plaza, and Best Buy are located.
Is there any talk in this plan? Does the plan address at all future annexation? I mean, as that growth continues to push down Meridian, what does the plan address there?
The plan itself does not really address future annexation. The plan boundaries are fairly firmly set. The city's comprehensive plan as a whole does anticipate some annexation in that area, although our south city limits are pretty well set in place.
You know, when I was kind of looking at maps, it looks like some of the growth is going to come. You have a lot of growth right on Meridian itself, but now we're going to start and build out off of Meridian. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, primarily the corridor between Bradley Lake Park and the YMCA, there's a lot of vacant property in that area, and we've seen a lot of interest from developers, particularly related to senior housing facilities. But they're certainly looking at that area for future growth opportunities.
And you had also talked about building height. How high, how much different is it going to look now? What would people notice?
Mm-hmm. Building heights in that area, in the commercial area, historically, have been around 5 stories, although that's an allowance. We haven't actually seen development achieve that height. Building height allowances in the mall area are now allowed up to 7 stories, with the potential for bonuses beyond that to 10 stories.
Let's talk a little bit about maybe the process of how the plan came to be. So did you have public comment, public outreach? What did you do there?
Yeah, there's certainly been a lot of public outreach done related to this plan. It's actually something that's been in the works for about 10 years now. So a lot of the initial visioning process was done about 10 years ago when the plan kicked off. There have been a number of starts and stops throughout developing this plan, but we've done numerous open houses, online comment opportunities, and had a number of meetings where the community has been able to weigh in and help shape the plan and vision for the area.
Let's talk a little bit about the timeline and what happens now that the plan was adopted in mm-hmm. February, took effect in February. What kind of happens now? Is it something that sits on a shelf? Is it a really active document? What happens
Sure.
now?
Sure. So again, the biggest change that we're seeing is some new zoning designations taking effect. And so there will be development proposals under that new zoning that we're seeing starting to come in. Other things to implement the plan will be road projects, park improvements, trail access, that sort of thing.
Interesting. And are there other parts of the plan that didn't maybe get a lot of exposure but are kind of little nuggets that you think people would really find valuable?
I think just really understanding that the vision for the future of that area is very different than what it looks like today. I think people have a hard time seeing something in their mind that's different than the build out that we've seen there up until now. But we really do believe that implementing this plan will give us a more walkable community in that area, something that's much safer, more desirable for people to live. And I think just really understanding that vision, that it will be very different 30 years from now.
That if you can get people living there, getting out of their cars and accessing, that it's going to change everything.
Yeah, there are great amenities and opportunities in that area. It's just really building up those opportunities for people to connect in an easier, safer way.
And then let's touch on Shaw Road really quick. Mm-hmm. How would you describe that as kind of a main corridor coming off of South Hill?
Right, Shaw Road is definitely the primary north-south connection on the east side of town. It's a very busy, well-used corridor. There are many people that live in that area, both in city limits and in the county, that use Shaw Road to get through town on that side of town.
Let's talk a little bit. There's a big construction project coming mm-hmm. up to expand Shaw Road. What is it going to look like, and when will all that kind of that start?
So the Shaw Road construction project, it's a multi-phase road project. There are a lot of steps and phases involved in fully building out that corridor, but we certainly need to alleviate some congestion there and provide safer bike and pedestrian facilities. So the first phase will be starting construction in a few months, I believe in May of this year, and will last through the summer into the fall.
Well, anything else I didn't ask that you want to add at all?
I think that covers everything.
Great. Thank you for being with us today, Katie.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Coming up next, what's an ad hoc committee? We'll explain how it affects you and decisions that come out of the Pierce County Council. Stay with us.
Hey, Gabby, how you doing? How's the play date and sleepover?
Dad, it was great.
Awesome. Okay, I'm on my way. Hey, guys, what are you doing?
We're going swimming.
We're going biking.
Yeah.
I'll see you in a little bit, guys. I love you.
Hi, babe. How was school today?
Hi, Dad. It was great.
Okay, honey, I'll be home soon. Remember, you're never too far away from your kids to be a dad. Reach out and take a second to check in, because sometimes the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
The Pierce County Council sets policy and approves the annual budget, but arriving at those decisions takes a lot of research. Let's take a deeper dive into the work of ad hoc committees.
On the 10th floor of the County City Building in downtown Tacoma, before the Pierce County Council ever gets to a final vote in the council chambers, the real work to understand an issue starts months earlier down the hall.
So they're no longer under the jurisdiction of the council.
This is the Ad Hoc Committee on Human Services. Ad hocs are created to cover a specific topic for a short period of time. Only three of the seven council members sit on this kind of committee, and their job is to examine the nuts and bolts of a topic, the kind of time-consuming work that would be difficult for every council member to do on every issue. This Ad Hoc on Human Services makes sure the recommendations from a behavioral health study are truly feasible.
Well, we have this particular one, this Ad Hoc Committee on Human Services, so we can, in a sense, focus a little bit more on that, specialize in it, get it into the details, into the weeds, if you will.
An ad hoc is not a decision-making body, but it does send recommendations to the rest of the council. In this case, the data and information gathered here will go on to the Public Safety, Human Services, and Budget Committee. Then it's on to the full council.
Oftentimes we become more skilled. You know, the more involved we are in these committees, the more knowledgeable we become so we can best serve our citizens.
The Pierce County Council currently has two ad hoc committees, this one on human services and another that takes a deeper dive into the budget. They meet twice a month. Dave Kelman for Pierce County TV.
To help us better understand what ad hoc committees do and how it impacts the work of the Pierce County Council, we have two guests today, Chair of the Council, Doug Richardson, and Councilmember Connie Ladenburg with District 4. Both of you are ad hoc committee members. Welcome.
Thank you.
Well, thanks for having us. And, you know, I'll take that first one from you. An ad hoc committee, think of it also, another term for it would be select committee. And so in the case of Connie's ad hoc committee on human services, what we did is we extracted the human services issues from the Public Safety, Human Services, and Budget Committee and put it under Connie's committee to tackle very specific, you know, human services issues. And in my committee, as an example, we also took, we formed this Budget Committee not to take tasks away from the Public Safety and Budget Committee, but to do a deep dive in the 2018 budget.
You have study sessions already, and you have other kind of long-standing committees. Is this an extension of that? Is it the same work? How would you kind of describe?
Our study sessions are broad. The ad hoc committee is subject-related, you know, so we can get deeper into those subjects week after, or meeting after meeting. We don't meet weekly, but meeting after meeting, you know, so. Whereas a study session can be different topics each week. So it's more briefings at the study session, and these are more in detailed.
Are they open to the public?
Oh, absolutely. Oh, yeah. Because
absolutely.
As the chair of the council, you know, the council by vote establishes committees, and any meeting of a committee is an open public meeting. The only difference here is there's three members on the committee, so a quorum would be two, but as opposed to the three required in a normal committee setting. But yeah, they're all open public meetings. They're all noticed. Right. They all are clerked. They're all recorded. So, yes.
And who else is there with you in these meetings? Who's giving you information and going through things? Who else joins you?
Well, we have, you know, regular staff, depending on what kind of information we're looking for, you know, this appropriate staff person is there. In my meetings, we've had a couple people from the executive's office attend, and so they're there to give us information, background information a lot of times, you know, so we're better informed, you know, because we don't have all the answers. You know, they're there to help us, you know, get to the answers that we're looking for.
How would you describe the atmosphere of the meetings?
I would like to think of them, at least mine, is more casual, more of a discussion type of a format, not quite as formal as some of our other committee meetings, subcommittee meetings, and study sessions, which I prefer for this type. It lends itself to a dialogue, you know, get input, you know, kind of hash things out a little bit more. It's a good format for this purpose.
Is it easier to get into kind of difficult topics, issues with less people?
I wouldn't say that. you know, the reason why, again, we really, these ad hoc committees are little mini committees in your case of public safety, human services. But just in a matter of time, you know, if you have each time you increase the size of the committee and there are questions, then it's harder to get a lot of things done when in that case. Because remember, these committees exist to make recommendations to the full council. So there's no, we're only going to put these three people on to have all the information, because all these committees can do is make recommendations for the full council to deliberate. So, you know, it's not to keep it away from anything like that.
Is it really, how would you kind of describe the research and the information that you're gathering, the time that that takes? It's not, you know, I get the assumption that it's not realistic to assume that every council member could take the time that it really takes to investigate every single issue that you guys have to cover and vote on. You know, that's really what these ad hocs do, is that you can dive into a subject.
Well, I'll speak for Connie's committee as an example. You know, we finished 2016 realizing that we still had work to do in the area of behavioral health. And, you know, we needed to determine that which we could do right now, and what steps could we take to implement the study that we had conducted. And so, yeah, it's very narrowly focused on, you know, how do we implement those things? What resources would we have to have? Mm-hmm. You might want to talk a little bit about the coordinator position as an example.
Right. You know, what we're doing is we're looking at the study that we had done last year, the council, you know, had done, and the elements or recommendations from that study that we can move forward on that doesn't require that 0.1% tax. One of the things that they recommended is that we form a coordinating committee of stakeholders in the community and also an administrator, coordinator, you know, whatever title we decide to give that person. And so those are the two items that we're working on right now. You know, we'll be doing more, but the coordinator position, we're already developing a job description and then a job announcement. So we will be hiring someone that will actually work in the council office. So it'll be probably equal to one of our research analysts that we currently have, but specific toward human services types of issues.
And similarly, we ended 2016 with a need to look at, okay, in an over $900 million budget, you know, how are we expending funds? Take another look at it. Are we spending them in the right places? To find out where we could find revenues to perhaps fund that coordinator position or other changes in the budget as we get ready to prepare the 2018 budget,
right,
which will be upon us very soon.
Right.
Interesting. What do you do with all the information that you gather out of this committee?
Well, we make recommendations to the council. You know, I mean, the committee decides, you know, basically the priorities that are coming out of that committee, recommendations and things like that, that we can then take to the council. Like this example that I just gave you in regards to the staff person, that's not our decision, final decision to make. You know, we will recommend that, you know, in a form of an ordinance. Ordinance
for the coordinator, but yeah, we also have to, you know, draft resolutions to submit to the council.
Right.
Because that coordinating committee, as an example, we have to establish it. It doesn't exist.
Yes.
And so that's what we're doing. We'll be cranking out resolutions and that sort of thing to then take to the full council, perhaps in a study session, to let them know what it is we think we should do going forward.
How much weight does the council put on the recommendations that come from an ad hoc committee?
Well, I hope they put a whole bunch of weight on it. Well, I don't know. I guess we'll wait and see.
Well, you know, you always got to count to four, right? So if you have unanimity on the ad hoc committee, you just got to get one other person
right,
to agree with
you. Right, because there's three. I don't know if we clarified that earlier, but there's the chair and two other members on an ad hoc committee. And so, as Doug said, we have to have four, you know, to pass anything. So we would have to get one other person.
Right, but if you have three ad hoc ins, you added another council member in there.
Yeah. It's a done deal.
What are some ways that you can encourage people to get involved with this process, or if they have questions about an ad hoc committee or participating, attending, what would you recommend?
Well, I think Connie would speak highly of our current webpage on the ability to go up there, the council website, seriously, and it has a list of meetings there, and there is a selection for ad hoc committees, and you click there, and you can download the agenda, the packets that we're going to be reviewing at the meetings. So it's all out there. As I said, we notice it just like we do any other committee meeting.
Right. The website's the best way to get information.
Good. Well, Council Members Richardson, Ladenburg, thank you for being here with us today.
Thanks for having us.
That wraps up this edition of Pierce County Talks. You can watch this program online or on our mobile app at piercecountytv.org. I'm Megan Hutton. Thanks for joining us.